Lord God, God of all goodness and God of all grace, in your mercy, we ask that you may disclose your mind and your will to us, your people, as we seek to be obedient, following upon your call to be a holy people. Grant now that we may hear you and respond appropriately in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. My brothers and sisters, I do not think that by any means I can make any claim or I can claim any warrant that is above and beyond that of which any of my colleague sisters and brothers would have had to be standing here this morning on this occasion at this event. I am deeply aware of my own personal inadequacies, generally, and even more so of such inadequacies to be the speaker at this gathering. Nevertheless, I give thanks to my sisters and brothers who have entrusted to me this obligation and this opportunity. This responsibility and this privilege to be God's messenger in our midst at this time. I'm indeed very grateful for the prayers that have gone up for me and for the event and for the graces of goodwill that have been expressed and extended to me. This morning, the thoughts that I shall share are expressive of the moral vision, the moral conviction, and the moral action that are summed up in words quoted for us already, thus confirming my choice. Words of the prophet Micah, who wrote, "What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God?" I am sure that everyone present here and others listening and looking from elsewhere, that you will agree with me that the times and the moments in which we live are not ordinary times, and they are not ordinary moments. Ironically, these are times in which we know of the possibilities for good. We see possibilities of satisfying fulfillment of purpose as we proceed on the way to development. These are times when we see signs of the possibility of achieving good things among ourselves. Yet these are times that can be rightly characterized as times of great anxiety, kind of existential troubledness of mind and heart and soul. In this, for example, we are at this moment sensing a shaking, quaking of the religious and moral foundations. And as a result, there is ever deepening sense of disappointment. There is a deep and ever deepening sense of disillusionment. There is a deep and ever deepening sense of near despair with its threatening impact of paralysis of the moral will and moral purpose. For this, we grieve. For this, we are ever remorseful. For this, we ask the forgiveness of God in Jesus Christ, and the forgiveness of all, especially those for whom it has been a source of offense and stumbling. At the same time, we also sense in some instances that we are a people at odds with ourselves. We sense it in social discord, manifesting itself in some of the vilest, cruelest, heartless, senseless acts of criminal violence and actions. We also are aware of distressing and disturbing disparities, disparities of opportunity in areas of health, education, welfare, and the economic sphere. And these themselves create their own experiences of discontent, their own experiences of unease. One of the things that I would like to draw to our attention is that the words of the prophet Micah emerged from times that were similar to these times in which we live. Times of religious and moral distress, social discord, and economic disparities. And it was against this background that the prophet offered the moral vision, the moral conviction, and the moral action all in one, and these things in one, I am suggesting, provided an ethic for public engagement toward the common good and our human flourishing. This moral vision and conviction and action all in one, it was grounded on a threefold component of virtues, virtues that were meant to become the basis of the transformation of the prophet's people. And the assumption behind this ethic for public engagement grounded upon these virtues, the assumption is that the goals we have and the goals we embrace, that these goals will be unsustainable without the embrace of these virtues that undergird the ethic for public engagement for the common good. It is my desire, in the given time, to share with us thoughts on the component virtues that are necessary for the pursuit of our goal of authentic human flourishing. I am urging these virtues. I am encouraging these virtues as articulated by the prophet Micah as absolutely necessary for us at this time. I make one little pause to make a comment. As I seek to offer these virtues, I would love everyone to understand that speaking from the for the church, I do not offer these challenges. I do not offer these demands. And I do not offer these expectations in any self-exempting way for the church on any pinnacle of self-righteousness. This is being done from the point of view that we have a collective responsibility. And a collective responsibility for us as a church in obedience to the source of these virtues of the ethic for authentic public engagement. We offer these as a community of faith, and we offer these as citizens of our beloved land. Taking up then Micah's words, what does the Lord require of you? but to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. I offer three virtues embodied in principles set for our public engagement in the process of establishing a good society. Firstly, I think the prophet articulates and offers to us a principle that asks for enduring commitment to uphold, defend, and promote in all we do and all we say the immeasurable worth and sanctity of human dignity to do justice. And as he does that, he's presenting it as that without which we shall not be able to establish a viable and a wholesome community and nation. This, he thinks, is intrinsically human, as we are made in the image of God. Key to the biblical notion of justice is the idea of the immeasurable worth and sanctity of human dignity. Therefore, informal ways in our community, justice is a policy issue. As a policy issue, we debate it, we talk about it, we plan for it. And so we talk about structures, we talk about systems, we talk about technical functions and operations. And day by day, we bemoan the failures, the inadequacies, the needs, the shortcomings of the systems and the structures, as well as we celebrate the gallantries, we celebrate the excellences, we celebrate the tremendous achievements in spite of and despite. But my friends, the warning that comes from the scriptures is that as we address justice as a public policy, we must never make the mistake of overlooking the indivisible link between justice and human dignity. Therefore, in our public rhetoric, therefore, in our suggestions, therefore, in our considered solutions, therefore, in our expectations, therefore, in our prescriptions, we must always remember that human dignity is at stake. It is vital. Now, it is going to take some moral courage. It is going to take some moral daring to bear in mind, looking at justice as a policy issue, to link it with the immeasurable worth and sanctity of human dignity. Given the situation in which we are, and the kind of things that are happening to us. But could I make the plea that we must bear in mind the linkage between justice and human dignity? But in a hurry, I just want to say that that's one side of the story when it comes on to the biblical concept of justice. Justice indeed is a policy issue. It has to do with structures. It has to do with systems. But at the same time, in the Bible, justice has to do with the kind of people we are. Justice has to do with the kind of people we are, character-wise. For justice is a virtue, quality of character. Virtue, quality of who we are. And so it is that dominant disposition that motivates, that dominant disposition that informs our attitudes, our ways, our dealings, our relational responsibility. And the message that one would like to communicate at this point is that the justice of a society depends upon the justice of its individual members. There is a real way in which we must bear this in mind. Just as the justice of the individual members is influenced by the presence or absence of justice, but in a real way, the justice of a society as a virtue of character depends on the justice of individual members of the society, doing justice. There is a sense, my brothers and sisters, in which there is something native, something natural about this vision of justice that emerges from the Bible. And the best evidence of this, my friends, is that plaintive, intuitive cry that we hear from time to time that links justice with human dignity. We hear it. We want justice. And we must not let our stereotypical perspective on the sources prevent us from understanding that it is an intuitive, native cry that links justice with human dignity. So then, what does this say? Justice is your responsibility. It is my responsibility. What is it saying? It is saying that I am accountable for justice and you are accountable for justice. What is it saying? It is saying that I have a contribution to make to justice and you have a contribution to make to justice. It is saying that none of us sitting here and nobody hearing me ought to be a beneficiary of injustice with a good conscience. It is saying, my friends, none of us sitting here ought to be a recipient of the fruits of injustice and remain smug about it. It is saying that none of us here ought to be dealing unjustly with others and at the same time demanding justice. Instead, my brothers and sisters, instead, we who see justice not merely as a policy issue, but as a virtue of character. Instead, all of us need to come together. And we need to come together to seek, to ensure that every member of our society has access to the goods, the services, the opportunities, the possibilities that will lead to a viable life of dignity. This is our task, my brothers and sisters. And if we do that, then we shall be looking out for those without the muscle, without the leverage to make themselves legitimate members of the society. And we shall be caring for them. Can I beg then that we listen again to the prophet Micah? What does the Lord require of us? To do justice, an abiding commitment in all we say and do, to uphold, defend, promote the immeasurable worth and the sanctity of human dignity. Please permit me just to make another suggestion emerging from the prophet Micah. Another virtue ethic for public engagement in our attempt to structure a community of human flourishing. It is this: an abiding commitment to create and sustain a culture of self-giving solidarity with those who are wounded and are suffering in community. To love mercy, an abiding commitment to create and sustain a self-giving solidarity with those who are wounded and those who are suffering in our community, my brothers and my sisters. Augustine of Hippo, a great church father, how does he put it? He puts it this way, that this kind of thing is a fellow feeling in our hearts for another's misery that compels us to help with every means in our power. Every means in our power. And for us of the religious community, this brings together love of God and love of our fellow human being. For us in the religious community and all of us who share a sense of godliness and goodness, it means that our common humanity commits us to this self-giving solidarity with the wounded and the suffering in our society. You know the word? It is a word that is losing its meaning, but the real word is compassion. There can be no just society without compassion, and there can be no compassionate society without justice. Three things in one come together at this point to love mercy. One, it is the capacity to feel for, but above all, to feel with. To feel for and to feel with. Secondly, it is to know about with caring interest. And thirdly, It is to take effective action to restore loss. It is to take effective action in response to address the deprivation, the disadvantage, to address the suffering and the pain, my brother. So what does that mean? It means to restore those around us. It means to reinstate human integrity and dignity. It means to honor personhood, to honor personhood. And as we do this, my brothers and sisters, let us learn that cultivating then this culture of self-giving solidarity, what it really means then is that this is not an act of isolated individuals. It is not an act of isolated individuals. It means a collective action. It means social practice. It means community orientation. It means a cultural distinctive. This is what it really means, my brothers and sisters. It means that we just do not do this to individuals. The solidarity is not only with individuals who have suffered, but with types, with classes, with groups. That's what it means. So the weak, the vulnerable, the innocent, the children, the women, the homeless, all of these people will become part of this self-giving solidarity. It means, my friends, that it is not limited to those who are present to us immediately. But it means also that once our consciousness is touched by human suffering from anywhere, we ourselves are touched. I just hurry to say this. And I want to say, having said this, it means that it is absolutely morally unacceptable and indefensible to use anybody's suffering in a self-serving manner. I just simply need to make the point for church and for everybody else that it is morally unacceptable and morally indefensible to use any body's suffering, any suffering of any group, to advance our own self-interest. If we do that, one of the things we don't see, we doubly victimize them. For they are already victimized, and now we make them usable. We victimize them over and over again. I am begging, I am pleading that we remember this. And yet, I am talking to policymakers, I'm talking to church members, I'm talking to people. Attached to this is a serious moral daring, serious moral courage. Because I am a preacher, I don't think you have noticed the relational link that Micah makes with justice and mercy. Therefore, for Micah, justice and mercy are not incompatible. Justice and mercy are not contradictory. No, my brothers and sisters. They belong together, and I repeat, a just society is a compassionate society. And a compassionate society is a just society. Therefore, compassion and mercy do not mean disregarding sanctions. Justice demands sanctions. Therefore, I need to say that compassion and mercy do not suspend sanctions. I need to say that justice and mercy do not even necessarily mitigate sanctions. But I need to say, when it comes down to biblical mercy and biblical compassion, what we need to know is that mercy does not stop with the retributive. It does not stop with the deterrent factor. But mercy goes on to the rehabilitative, to the redemptive. And this is where our problem comes, because it is something to be extended to those who even deserve their suffering. That's the problem. That's the problem. Even those who deserve their suffering, because mercy is redemptive, rehabilitative, it must be extended even to those who deserve their suffering. Because of our shared humanity, because of faith, hope, and love. I just end with this. I'll get it out of the way quickly, but I end with this. The ethic of public engagement, as I indicated, is of a threefold nature. I've given you the the one that I think also that we need to face, coming from the prophet Micah. It comes to us asking for an abiding commitment to developing and sustaining a thoughtful maturity. He's asking us to develop and sustain a thoughtful maturity. Walk with humility. And what does this really mean? It simply means that we must have a proper understanding of ourselves in the scheme of things. We must have a proper understanding of ourselves, individual selves and collective selves in the scheme of things, as we work together to develop a community that shares the common good and leads us into wholesomeness of a flourishing humanity. We cannot, for God's sake, we cannot go on and try in any way to foster a community which allows some people to think of themselves more highly than they ought. I am begging, neither must we develop a community that causes people to think of themselves lower than they ought. Wherever and whenever this happens, we are sowing the seeds for social self-destruction. For on the one hand, if we allow people to think of themselves more highly than they ought, we are inviting arrogance. We are inviting authoritarianism. We are inviting and sanctifying discrimination and exclusion. And on the other hand, if we make people think less of themselves than they really ought, we are inviting resentment. We are inviting bitterness. We are inviting anger. Can I ask, can I beg my brothers and my sisters? And I speak to the church and I speak to everyone. Look, my friends, we are plotting our own downfall. And in plotting our own downfall, we will bring down many others with us. One, if we put ourselves beyond compliance with ordinary rules of decency and goodness. If we think we have an overrated capacity to manipulate things so that the consequences of our immorality do not catch upon us, we are plotting our own downfall. And if we underrate the resilience of the moral imperative, it will catch up with us sooner or later. And in these days, sooner rather than later. My brothers and sisters, what I'm asking for is a sober, wise, well-reasoned awareness of our own limitations. That's humility. Our own limitations. Our own vulnerabilities, our own frailties. I am asking for a willingness, a serious willingness to admit our wrongs, our mistakes, and to accept accountability for them. I am asking them with humility for an openness to correction, openness to transformation. I am begging, I am pleading for humility. Humility liberates us to admit our dependence on others. Humility liberates us to learn from others. Humility liberates us to work with others. But it takes moral courage. It takes moral courage in a world that humility is not a choice virtue of this world in its lack of humility itself. So our world believes in self-glorification. In the church, you ought to know this. You ought to know this. And in the world, the world, church people like to curse worldliness. And sometimes it's the length of the skirt you wear rather than your love of self-glorification. My brothers and my sisters, the world promotes self-glorification. It promotes name recognition. It promotes a sense of importance based on its own ratings and poll ratings. It takes moral courage to depart from that. My plea is just to let you know that humility facilitates learning from one another. Humility facilitates balanced discourse, even when we differ. Humility facilitates the possibility of working together for the common good as the prophet saw it. What is my message this morning? What is my plea this morning? It's simply that we embrace an ethic of public engagement toward the establishment of a society that celebrates the common good and human flourishing. Such an ethic must be grounded on certain virtues. And these virtues work in a way that they lead us to an abiding commitment to uphold, to defend, and to promote the immeasurable worth and the sanctity of human dignity in all we do and all we say. An abiding commitment to cultivate and sustain a culture of self-giving solidarity with those who are wounded and are suffering in our society. An abiding commitment to develop, maintain, and display a thoughtful maturity, doing justice, loving mercy, and walking humbly.